Welcome back, everybody. It's time once again for another episode of the Pedego Podcast as we ride along on the e-bike revolution with the entrepreneurs behind this movement and the love stories of those just riding along. And today, well, we've got a love story that you're going to love. I already like the part of it I've heard so far. It's quite a dramatic tale here with our guest from Chicago. I want to make sure I don't say it like too many Midwesterners mispronounce it. Chicago. We've got Tom Zanatti. Tom Zanatti, welcome.
Thank you, Paul. How you doing?
You live in where? Wheaton, which, if I remember correctly, is a suburb.
I live in Barrington, Illinois.
Oh, Barrington.
I'm 41 miles from the store.
One of my best buddies from college was from Barrington. Nice, wonderful suburban neighborhood, not unlike the suburban neighborhoods I grew up in outside of Detroit here. Very leafy, lots of trees, as I recall, all that area there. Beautiful country. But it hasn't been all roses for you back there. Tell us a little bit about your journey. It's a severe one because you severed the sciatica nerve and your left foot's basically paralyzed since then. How and when did that happen?
Well, it was November 17th, 1979, and I was on my way home from a girlfriend's house, and I got nudged by another car and hit a bridge, hit the underpass, and the engine came through the firewall, landed on my legs, and the drive shaft came up through the floorboard and went through the back side of my left leg, which cut everything back there in half. Oh. And the doctors at the time, Dr. Hora Lidge and Nesset, did the best they could to save the leg. Grateful. But in the meantime, I lived in constant pain. I had skin grafts on my knees and multiple fracture both feet. And part of my recovery was the left leg was bent. I had to get that straight, and I had to get the skin graft off the top of the kneecap. So I had a set of stairs in front of the house I grew up in Palatine, Illinois, mm-hmm. right next to Barrington. And I would put my crutches across my bicycle, and I would get up on the stairs, get my leg up over the bicycle and push myself off and continue to ride. You know, and I rode my whole life as a boy every day. So that was my therapy, and I've always worked through it. And to this day, I can be in pain and sit around, or I can get on this recliner of a bicycle and ride around.
And get out.
And
so
let's
talk about
it. It's just
that.
So comfortable.
All right. So that's why we brought you on, because I appreciate, first of all, that you're willing to share the story. Not everybody wants to recall or recount this. I'm sure you've retold this a million times in a million ways to a million people here. And yeah, thank you for coming on
it's
and sharing.
It's not easy for me to talk about me.
Well, you know, not these kinds of stories either, particularly. All right, so this happened, and you had a choice. I can be on crutches, I can stay home, I can be in pain, I am in pain, or I can try and work through this. Was riding just a mental therapy, or did it help the leg in any way?
Oh, without a doubt, with the circulation and the mental therapy end of it, yes, but the physical part with the cardiovascular. You know, you're still using your hands and your shoulders, and you've got your stomach muscles contracted, and you're out there riding. And
but this is Chicago, which has got the worst weather in the Midwest. I mean, if you want to see snow, go to Chicago. I grew up in Minnesota. That's also bad. And then outside of Detroit, we were like paradise compared to the blizzards that would come off of the lake and those areas there. So did that limit the amount of months? Is this just a summer activity and the rest of the time you're stuck indoors?
Depending if they have the roads opened up. There's times when I've been able to ride in the winter. It's crazy. You know, 2 years ago on December 22nd, I was riding my bicycle. It was 55 degrees.
Yeah, well, the weather is changing everywhere,
you
that's
know,
for sure.
It's amazing. It's not like it used to be. So I pretty much can bike all winter long. In March, I was, you know, out there early and stuff, and I was riding along the Fox River Trail right here in Illinois, not far from my house, 17 right. miles, I think, I'm there. I was dogging it. It hurt. I felt like I was doing more damage than good.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I was really, it hurt. It was. It was doing more damage than, I wasn't helping myself. As you know, I'm 61 years old now. And
I was going to ask, I was afraid to ask, you're a man of a certain age, as am I.
And I made up my mind that day. I stayed at a hotel 50 miles from my house and or whatever, 40 miles from my house. And then the next day I started searching for electric bicycles, pedal assist bicycles. And then I came across Karen at Pedego, and she made arrangements for me to come in the next day and meet with her to look at bicycles. And I knew that I was, because of how my legs felt, wasn't going to be able to do it again this year without help. I knew I was going to walk out with a bicycle. I knew I was going to walk out with saddle bags. My mind was made up that I needed help, but I lucked out. You know, I feel like I lucked out with the help that I got there and the service. And,
well, we'll go through that in a minute. I want to hear the story of how they got you on a bike. This idea first is that, did you have any reluctance? Because we've heard too many people come on and say, you know, I'm a serious biker. This isn't serious. This is just for, I don't know, this is just for old people or kids or for fun. It's not really bicycling. Did you have any feelings of that at all?
No, because I have combined bird watching and bicycling my
you
whole
too.
Life as well.
Okay.
And so I'm a big birder. I get the spots by bicycle that other guys can't get to, you know? Not that I'm off-roading, but I'm able to get to the areas and be in solitude with birds.
As I remember the area, there are tons and tons of migratory birds that come down from Canada at certain times of year or go back up. I smile because I knew lots of people that were into birds. Oh, my dad used to have bird feeders all over because you get these big lots back there in the Midwest. It seemed like every tree had a bird feeder on it, so I get it. All right, so now you're out in nature and you decide really quickly that you're going to get an e-bike. What was it that attracted you to this store and to, was her name Karen? Is that it, the dealer there?
Yeah, she's one of the owners. There's two couples that own the store. Just very little research. And as soon as I, you know, she called back and that was it. My, you know, I didn't call anybody else. Being honest, I didn't research it beyond that point. And when I went in, being around bicycles my whole life, I saw how this thing is made and stuff like that. It just seemed like me. I saw the step through. You know, I'm thinking, oh, God, that's perfect for me.
Yeah,
you
right.
know?
Which model did you get? You got the Interceptor, I think they told me?
Yes.
Okay. And so you instantly took to it. You said, I see it's well-built. Was it the convenience of having a dealer there? I don't know. I mean, I don't know how people find e-bikes when they suddenly wake up and say,
I
want
like
one.
I don't regret it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like it's something that is going to get old. Mm. For me, you know, it's because it's a big part of my life.
Yeah.
I'm out there, you know. It's what I do. You know, I burn and I bike.
You burn
and
your bike.
I enjoy to do. I burn and bike. I enjoy it. And I like the idea of being able to do long distances.
And they tell me you've done over 3,000 miles since April? Come on, that's got to be a mistype
here. No, I'm 129 short of 5,000.
Oh, 5,000. I did have it wrong. 5,000.
Yeah, I did 72 yesterday.
Oh, my goodness. But, Tom, you got a severed sciatica and a left foot,
you know,
that doesn't work as well.
About, like, the runner's high, you know? Well, I guess for me, it's the same way with the bicycle. It's better for me to be out there and moving, because it does. It gives relief.
Yeah.
I'm better off for doing it.
And is it a mental thing as well as a physical thing, or is it just getting the blood pumping and getting...
If you can imagine, just in this season alone, the things I've seen. I rode up the whole Lake Michigan lakefront up to Green Bay, Wisconsin.
Up to Green Bay, Wisconsin? That's almost...
Yeah, I went all the way up to Marion, the week before Memorial Day. I've been to Galena. I've been to the Mississippi River twice. I've been on the Illinois-Michigan Canal Trail.
Wow.
I went from Two Rivers, Wisconsin on the way back from Marionette County all the way to Montrose Beach in downtown Chicago.
Stop me for a second here.
I stayed in hotels along the way.
You're riding through downtown, or I don't know if they can still call it the Loop or the Gold Mile or what all that area. That's really intense traffic. That's like downtown New York, downtown.
Yeah, but you have the lakefront bicycle path.
Oh, okay. All right.
So you're right. When I went from like Sheboygan to Two Rivers, you're on the Mariner's Trail. You know, you're going past lighthouses and Coast Guard stations, and you're right up along the lakefront and just miles of Lake Michigan along you. It was wonderful. Through Milwaukee, through Sheboygan, Two Sisters. It was just incredible.
All those places bring back memories for me. I did live in Milwaukee for a while. We moved all over the Midwest, and Milwaukee was one of the places we had. I went from Minnesota to Michigan to Milwaukee to other places around. When I was a kid, everybody rode a bike. But, you know, this is a long time ago. I don't think of that as biking country, maybe because it is cold and frozen. But you're telling me lots and lots of trails, lots of places to go. Is this a biking-friendly place?
Well, to a point, but you got to know your way around. Lake Michigan from my house is 27 miles, the shortest route, down Route 68, Dundee Road, straight to Lake Michigan. But if I cut out of my house, cut through Deer Grove, come out of Palatine Hills Golf Course, cut through their bicycle trail, I can get under Route 53 and then get over to Dundee Road, and for 20 miles straight down to Lake Michigan, there's sidewalks the whole way.
Wow. Yeah. See, there you
go. So I don't have to get on the road. I go past the Chicago Botanic Gardens. Their gift shop is 25 miles from my house.
You know exactly.
Chicago Botanic Gardens. And it's a 2 more miles past Ravinia Music Theater and up to Lake Michigan down at Glencoe Beach, which is just gorgeous, you know.
I got a big smile on my face just remembering some of the places, because I have been to Chicago many times. Chicago is like the crown jewel of the Midwest back there. Everybody hangs around. You know, there's lots and lots of lakes like there is everywhere, but the lake, Lake Michigan. I didn't know you could go that far up the lake all the way. I mean, Green Bay, Wisconsin, that's
hours.
There's
a trail straight down Green Bay, and then now it's bicycle-friendly through Evanston on Sheridan Road, and then it ties into the North Shore Trail up in Evanston. Go all the way down Lake Michigan. I haven't been on it, but there's a new pedestrian bicycle ramp that are separate that go up and over the Chicago River there.
Oh,
I haven't been on that part.
I was going to say, because I would think there'd be lots of obstacles in the way, but they've made it more bike-friendly like so many big cities and metropolitan areas have. All right, so does the e-bike let you go, keep going because you're getting to be of a certain age and it's getting harder, or does it let you go farther, or both?
It's allowed me to be back out there.
Yeah.
To continue to do the things I like to do.
So how many miles are you going to put on this sucker? I had in my notes, they said, well, I think he's ridden 3,000 miles since April. You said, no, it's 5,000. You're going to ride 100,000? You're going to ride around the world? I mean, how far are you going to go on this thing?
You know, I'd love to do Route 66.
Yeah.
You know, I would love to do it. Go down to the Gulf of Mexico. There's a trail down the Mississippi River. It's an old railroad trail. Might want to get back to the Hennepin Canal Trail. I've only been to the 10th lock. It takes you to the Mississippi River.
Yeah.
And then in Moline, I believe.
Now, the Mississippi River doesn't run through Chicago, but not far away from there. Comes through Minneapolis and goes straight down.
No,
somewhere.
It took me 3 days to get there when I went to Savannah, Illinois. I left North Avenue Beach.
Uh-huh.
And went all the way down the Great Western Trail to Sycamore the first day. And then I went to...
be telling me any city. I'm just nodding.
Oregon,
here, you know.
Oregon. Oregon, Illinois, on the Rock River. And then from Oregon, I went to Savannah, Illinois, on the Mississippi River. And I did that Easter weekend. Went up to Galena, Illinois, which is gorgeous.
Yeah.
And then back through Elizabeth and Stockton. And then from Stockton, because I bought another battery, I carry an extra battery. I went from Stockton to back to Sycamore in one day. I did 104 miles.
In one day. Oh, my God. All right. So here's my last question. When you're out on the road, and I'm assuming you're doing this solo for the most part, or do other people ride along with you?
Yeah, I've been by myself, yeah.
All right. So you're out on the road, long distances, beautiful trails, along old canals, old railroads, along the rivers, along the lakes and stuff.
Churches. The history is just incredible.
All right. So what do people say when they see you riding by? Do they wave? Do they look strange?
They love to ask questions. You're from where?
Yeah, right.
What are you doing?
How did you get here?
Some of the people, I was going along a trail through like a farm field area. And I could see that some people were foraging for something. And it was an older woman, a girl maybe in her late 30s, and her children. And I asked, what are you foraging for? And I knew it was either morels or...
mushrooms.
Yeah. Or asparagus.
Oh,
and she goes, oh, asparagus, can't you see it? And you know, I'm looking, and I finally did see it. She goes, it's over there. And I asked, well, how long have you been, has your family been foraging here? Oh, about 90 years, to meet people and have those experiences and be able to share time like that.
Yeah, that's everything.
God, I love it. I love it. God put me in a really cool spot.
Well, sounds like it. And he gave you the pedal power to go see it here and to get out in the world and the determination and the drive to get up and do it. Because too many people, I'm telling you back there, the only criticism I ever had of the Midwest is too many people get too sedentary. The snow comes, they start turning on the TV, stop talking, and they hibernate. And that sometimes carries over to their whole life. The harsh weather back there, and you got to be willing to go out and explore it, even when it's not beautiful and sunny like it is in California here all the time. So I appreciate that you get out and you go. You should write a journal or something. You should write a book about this or something. Do you take pictures along the way or anything here?
No, I really haven't been. And I've traveled, I really don't take a lot of pictures, you know. And I should. You're right.
Take a phone and just capture that journey.
I know the exact routes I took. You know, when backtracking, it's amazing that I really didn't even use maps.
You didn't use maps? What are you using, celestial guidance?
By direction and instinct on which way I was going.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, Lake Michigan's on my right, and I'm going north, you know?
You're like one of the pioneers.
Every dead end, every lighthouse, every no outlet, every little stone house, every giant stone house, through Kohler and Whispering Winds and the state parks, Schultz Autobahn Nature Preserve. I felt like I was migrating with the birds.
My image is of the pioneers crossing the plains, the people that first came across there, or the people who first lived. I mean, these go back to the early days of the country here, these neighborhoods that you're riding through here. Well, thank you for letting us ride along. I hope you keep going, and I hope you'll chronicle the journey along the way, because I think other people would be inspired and like to ride along with you, even if it's only virtually, even if it's only vicariously. I think you're an inspiration to a lot of people who otherwise would give up and say, the heck with it. Instead, you're like, heck no, let me go. And thank goodness you got a little extra assist so you can keep going farther and further into your years and further on the road as you go further and further with your Pedego bike here. Amazing stuff.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you for sharing it with us here today. Give us a shout out again for the store where you got this from. I'd love to hear their perspective on this, what they thought when you walked in the door. I'd love to hear their side of the story.
I don't think they were sure I was serious at first. I wanted to get saddlebags. I asked Karen on the phone, well, do you have saddlebags to go over the back of the bicycle?
Yeah.
And she goes, yes, we do. And I packed the bag. I had fleece-lined pants on when I showed up because I got dropped off. I took a cab there. I knew I was going to buy a bike.
You're going home with a bike, yeah.
I put my stuff in the bag. I had, socks and underwear and everything all packed. Oh. I knew I was going to do this, you know. And I rode from the store is on the Illinois Prairie Path.
So I took
the Illinois Prairie Path to the Fox River Trail, which is like 14 miles from their store, I'd say.
Gee.
And then I went north on the Fox River Trail and went all the way up to McHenry and had the charger with me. I went to a hotel, charged it up, and I kept the room for an extra night. So I continued my way up to the Wisconsin border in Genoa, Illinois, and then back to McHenry. That's when I decided I was going to need another battery.
Yeah, right.
Because 50 miles wasn't going to be enough.
Yeah.
You know, it seems like a lot. But, you know, when you're out there and you're enjoying it, you're zoned, you want to do more. You know, I just want to keep going.
Well, I'd like to keep going, but we've run out of time here again. So thank you, Tom Zanatti. Zanatti? I knew I was going to miss it.
Zanatti's fine.
Zanatti,
yeah.
Okay. Like Cincinnati. Tom Zanatti.
Yeah.
thank you for letting us ride along. Share your stories. It's an inspiration, and what a kick to hear your story. I really do think you should chronicle some of this stuff and take some pictures, put it on give it to the store, let them put it along here, because I'm sure they're just scratching their heads saying, this guy did what? He packed a bag, and he's taking a bike home, and he's going to ride like 50 miles the first day? That doesn't happen every day. Thank you so much for coming on the Pedego Podcast.
Have a great day.
Well, there you have it, folks. If that doesn't inspire you to get out on the road, I don't know what will. So many stories like that. So many people riding along, changing their lives and those around them. Join us for another episode of the Pedego Podcast as we explore the e-bike revolution and the entrepreneurs behind the movement and the love stories of those riding along. Brought to you by Pedego Electric Bikes. For more information, just visit pedego.com. That's P-E-D-E-G-O, pedego.com.